William Salyers, everybody.
Hi, guys. Thanks for coming to this. I don't really know what it is, so it's going to be fun.
Not everyone at once, because we can't handle the volume. But if you have a question, go ahead and we'll do the old-fashioned raise of the hand. I don't know why I looked like a Nazi when I did but I...
Off to a bad start.
Sorry, let me... There we go.
It's nay on the Otsy nay.
Yeah. Yes.
I think we should do a group selfie. With everybody in the room.
We can do that at the end.
That's a good idea. I like that.
Remind us.
I don't know,
because
I have other stuff to go
through. Whoa. Wow.
Do it now.
Like, can I get a picture and get the hell out of here?
I've got more selfies to take.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know about you people, but I got a life.
How about Rick in the back there?
Yeah.
When you were originally working on moral world, did you expect to be comedy the whole way through?
Dark comedy, yeah. I was pretty on board with that concept from the beginning. I really loved that show. It was really fun when they canceled it. Apparently it got dark. So, yeah. But, yeah, right. I thought it was hilarious myself. Yeah, but over here.
You're probably not the right person to ask, but I know there's a lot of weird creatures in Adventure Time.
Yeah.
Does J.G. Quinto have like a whole lore of what those creatures are? Or do you just kind of pop them out of nowhere?
Yeah, I think more the latter, and they're not really significant. I mean, one of the things that JG always stays away from, which I think is really interesting, like we were doing some improv once for, we're coming up with some lines for some promos, and I made some reference about, I made some reference about Rigby's tail, and he didn't want that in there because it, as far as JG's concerned, the fact that Rigby is a raccoon or that Mordecai's a blue jay, it's just irrelevant. You know, that's why you've got Frank, Margaret's dad, is not a bird, but Margaret is a bird. You know what I mean? So it's like, I think for him it was just about interesting visuals, and then the story stands alone. That makes sense? Yeah.
Okay.
Back there.
Yes, hi. How did you make the transition into voice acting?
Well, I had done a very tiny amount over the years that I was doing stage acting and doing TV, and didn't really think of it as a career thing. It wasn't really something, I enjoyed it, but it wasn't really something that I was looking to do. And then I was getting ready to go do a season of Summer Stock in Santa Fe, New Mexico, live theater, and this buddy of mine, Scott Adsit, who you guys might know from 30 Rock, he was one of the co-creators of Moral Oral. Brilliant improviser, Second City fame, you know. Scott called me up and was like, hey, you know, the Cartoon Network's gonna take our show. They're gonna put it on Adult Swim. I said, oh, great, man. He's like, we're not happy with, he said, we got the first season recorded, but we're not happy with one of the voices. Will you come in and read for it? And I just thought he was trying to throw me a bone and be a good friend, because I knew that there was no way I was gonna get cast in a cartoon. I mean, that's a tight, difficult world, you know. And he kind of had to sell me on the idea because I was getting ready to fly out of town. I was like, man, thanks, I really appreciate it, but like, I got to get ready to fly. And he was like, well, you're 5 minutes away, just come and read. So I thought, well, I don't want to be rude. So I went to the studio, and I wasn't at all nervous because I didn't think I was going to get the part. So I read and had a good time, and I got the part. And that sort of started it. So my first gig that sort of like gave me authenticity as a voice actor was Moral Oral, and from there I got an agent. And I'm happy to say that regular show was something I booked all on my own. I didn't know anybody involved. You bet.
A question over here.
Yes.
What was your favorite episode to act?
A regular show? You know, I really like the episode, and I don't remember what it's called anymore, but the one where Rigby used the Playco arm boy to cheat, and he arm wrestled Skips, and Skips was going crazy because he couldn't figure out how Rigby beat him. And my favorite part about that episode was that Skips actually accidentally kills Rigby and has to arm wrestle death to get him back to life. So I love the episodes where Rigby does something stupid and dies or becomes hospitalized as a result. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah.
If you're talking talking about in the main panel how you had Tyler the Creator and Chad the Gambino to wrap it up episode. Have you had any other celebrity guests besides Mark Hamill?
Oh, yeah, we have celebrity guests all the time. I mean, I know that Bob Goldthwait's been on the show, and, well, yeah, I wasn't there for that. I wish it could have been. Terry Crews, who else? There's been a bunch. I'm embarrassed to forget her name, who played, she played the wife in Married with Children, and she's one of the voices.
Oh, Seagal.
Yeah, Seagal. Yeah, she was on. She's amazing. Eddie Pepitone played voices my father. Voices
oh, I
voices.
Love him.
Yeah, he voices my father.
Yo, you guys, Eddie Pepitone is such a funny stand-up comic. He has a special on Netflix that is so underrated. But as a comedian, that is one of my all-time favorite specials. It's so weird and crazy. Please check it out. It's super cool.
He's hilarious when he comes in the booth. He's
oh
hilarious.
My God.
Yeah.
So funny.
He's really fun.
It's really dark. You have to like dark comedy.
I'm so there.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
I love Regular Show because it brings, you know, it bridges generation gaps.
Sure.
It's a show I can watch with my kids, and we enjoy it. We both laugh.
Awesome.
You know, and everything. My question is, I really dig that shirt. Where did you buy it?
I like that question. I've never gotten it before.
Stocky man.
Yeah, right.
Look out for shirts that, you know.
Yeah, yeah, I'm right there with you. My wife got me this shirt, and I don't know. I'm sorry, man.
And she won't tell you, right?
Yeah, well, if she did, I forgot. Because me. But, yeah, I totally. You know what? If I run into you, know, I'll ask her tonight on the phone. Be like, where'd I get this shirt? Yeah.
So we'll take one more question, and then we'll start the show. Okay, we got a little Kylo Ren over here.
All right.
Go for it.
What other shows do I watch besides Regular Show? Oh, on Cartoon Network. Oh, that's gonna limit me. You know, first of all, I do all my TV a la carte. We have a Roku and we just buy full set. And that dude is cosplaying as one of my all-time favorite cartoons.
Yeah.
I think Rick and Morty is twisted genius, and I would off somebody to get on that show.
Yeah. We could at least make the introduction happen.
Yeah. I could.
So why don't we just get started, right?
Yeah.
Right here.
And mythological creatures, expendable secondary characters, fat costume design, medical emergencies, cool cinematography, sports celebrities, partial nudity, underwater adventures, special effects, overhead crane shots, and more. The best DVD in the world at this moment in time. Buy it now.
Hear that? That's the sound of your party failing.
Is your party tanking fast? Then say hello to Party Pack. 16 Party Pack episodes of Regular Show.
I still don't know why that dude's green. I don't know what he's ever explained it to me.
What are you waiting for? I knew we'd find a party.
Yeah, we did.
Regular Show Party Pack.
Party Pack.
Buy it now on DVD.
We judged those pies in their face!
Yeah, we did!
Woo!
So you guys know, we do all of our own stunts.
Boom! Eat it, Jan!
Yeah! Regular Show, all new episodes. Monday nights at 8, 7 central, only on Cartoon Network.
Can't wait.
Play on.
Looks like we have choices to make.
It should be a control.
Oh, play all.
It's a piece of crap.
I was waiting for it to come.
Oh, no.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that, guys.
Thanks for watching Random Parts of Regular Show with us. And now there's no signal, so. Anyway.
Sure, well, let's go.
It was a dark and stormy night.
I suppose they could close their eyes and you could just do the voice.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
There you go.
You have a script on your phone, right?
Sure.
Most likely he does.
I've got a bunch of them actually in a big Rubbermaid tub in my garage.
Oh, you save all the scripts?
I used to, and then I realized that was stupid.
They take up a lot of room.
Yeah, they do. The storyboards. We used to get the storyboards. Now I get them in PDFs, which is the way to go. But I used to get. They used to messenger them over to me, and in huge manila envelopes that felt like they were still the tree. And those stack up pretty fast. Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
No, oh, that was.
That did nothing. Sorry. That's probably gonna restart.
So, and this is why you don't let performers be your tech guys.
Yeah, there's no. It just has a play button and a pause button.
And it won't even play.
It's a Blu-ray.
Ooh, fancy.
It's just gonna be.
So don't steal this and don't do something like show it to a whole bunch of people in one sitting who didn't pay to watch it. You know, don't videotape it.
Yeah, we're doing it more legal.
Thanks.
You're a lot for your trip.
Plus meet Bill.
So, we need a remote.
What the hell is that?
We need to get the menu. Because when this part's over, just the menu comes up. So,
it's
what do you think?
Give it a shot. See if you have any better luck, you know?
Narrate the commercials.
Yes.
Rigby.
There's no sound.
And we've already seen these, right?
Yeah.
Sit on me.
Jump on me.
Yeah,
with the
camera
people.
That's where we're standing.
Yeah. And this might be where she makes us look really stupid.
Just get on me.
Yeah.
How did you start, Lisa?
How did I start?
Yeah.
Well, I'm a stand-up, and I get that question a lot. Like, how do you get into comedy? And the answer to that is you just show up at an open mic and you're a comedian. Like, there's no, I used to think there was a big process too, but really if you just show up.
That sounds terrifying.
Like, you don't get a diploma or anything like that, you know? You just go, I'm a comedian, and then you are one. And, I guess a professional comedian is one that gets money.
Oh yeah, that's a thing.
So at some point, if you're funny, people pay you. So that's how.
Yeah, it's kind of like, you know, I could do funny voices in my closet all day.
Right?
Yeah.
And be a voiceover actor. You see, I help. Now, do you refer to it as a voiceover actor or a voiceover artist?
Oh, artist sounds snooty to me.
Yeah?
I just say I'm a voice guy.
Voice dude?
Yeah, I'm a voice dude. You know, I did some episodic television and I do theater a lot, but I like to say that my career really took off when I stopped insisting that my whole body be involved.
There you go. Well, the little bit of voiceover that I've done, and I love doing it, I have no idea how to do more of that, but the little bit that I've done has been so fun.
Yeah.
And also, there's no stress. There's less stress than being on camera, because when you're on camera, you've got that HD thing right in your face, and it's like, okay, you've all this prep to do before that with makeup and hair, and make sure you have a good night's rest before so you don't look like a dead person. And
I never do any of that.
Oh, a voiceover, you just show up in your pajamas.
Yeah.
Oh, it's the best.
I always have bags under my eyes like a dead person. and I don't have any hair. So that all works out great for me.
Oh, hair's overrated.
There's wigs.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
That's why hair's overrated.
There you go.
So
we need a remote for this. Oh, for sure. Thank you for trying them.
Yeah.
Technology, guys. Am I right or am I right? So we'll just keep doing question and answer until we get the episode going.
Yeah.
When you were like starting out,
yeah,
especially in animation,
yeah,
did you ever like shamelessly promote yourself by like saying something at 5:30 in room 104? A guy wearing orange will have an animation short playing there.
No, I've never done that. How does it work?
At 5:30 today in room 104,
yeah,
on this floor,
yeah,
there's a guy wearing a lot of orange and a green hat will, yeah, have an animation short playing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. All right.
That's today. In what room?
104.
At what time?
5:30.
All right, good to know.
Today, animated short, 5:30, right over there.
Excellent.
There's parties.
That was, well, very creative.
Yes.
Very subtle.
If I ever have to do it, I'm going to do it like that.
Bright colors, standing. Just don't, you know, do anything stupid like say there's a show of your animation at 5:30.
What's your name, man?
Sebastian.
Yes, I like you, Sebastian.
You do, yeah, the art yourself on your
yes.
That's,
yes,
cool.
Animation,
nice,
the whole deal.
Oh,
that's
right,
cool.
Okay, well, enough about you. Now we'll check it out, though. That's,
yeah,
awesome.
That's very cool.
5:30, right
on. Got it.
104. When you got into voice acting, did you start drinking any kind of tea or, you know, do any vocal warm-ups?
Oh, I'm glad I didn't go where I thought it was going.
I know, me too.
Single
booze do you drink,
yeah,
before a gig?
When you got into voice acting, did you start drinking really heavy? And the answer is yes. But no, you know, I do that. I do some stressful voices. I'm in a game called Evolve, which is a big Microsoft title where you play a team of guys that are taking, and girls, who are taking on a monster on a planet. It's a multiplayer co-op game. And the guy that I play, all the people in that are, all the heroes are huge and muscled, and like the guy I play is the little guy, and he looks like the biggest biker in a gang, you know. He smokes a cigar, and so, you want to play? I kind of got to go with something a little bit like this, you know. And I can do that for about 4 hours before I just have no voice left at all. So, something like that, I'll do teas or, you know, throat coat or loquat syrup or something like that. But ordinarily, I don't have to. Yeah, you bet.
I just want to mention, I just came from Fresh Pine to see you, sir.
Oh, thank you.
Do you have a remote? You serve your schedule, though.
I what?
I'm just kidding. What's your favorite, I don't know, did Rigby ever, get more punch
him
back hard enough, or never?
Oh, would Rigby punch Mordecai back?
Yeah, hard enough.
Oh, hard enough, no. Although he has an advantage because he comes up to right about Mordecai's waist, so if he ever wants to go for the low blow, he's right there.
Well, Kylo Ren again.
Sorry about that, we had to slip
for you. Oh. I'm sorry, can you say it louder?
Oh, no, sorry.
Although that was kind of an awesome bit we had going on there for a minute. What did you say? What was your question, young man?
Why did the artist think of Rigby to be a raccoon?
That's a great question. That came up at the panel today. I don't actually know the answer, although Sam, who went to school with JG, says that JG just enjoyed drawing a raccoon. So that's kind of how it happened. And in the hat.
How did you develop the voice?
How did I develop the voice for Rigby?
Yeah.
I can tell by his lines that he was a pretty angsty dude who hadn't really found his mellow. And so I just played him like I'd had about two pots of coffee.
When you get an audition like that, you have to put together what you think. You have to put together in your head what you think that character is going to sound like, and create a whole world in your own mind, and hope that this is what they're looking for, right?
Right. And then, I used to, when I was first starting out, I would really sweat that, you know. Like my favorite example, voice guys talk about all the time, is I'll get commercial copy once in a while, right? And so there'll be copy for, like, you know, a car ad or whatever, and they'll say, or a truck, truck ad, even better. They'll say, the copy will say, we don't want the typical sound. We want somebody who just sounds like a real person, like a regular guy. And so, you know, I'm like, you know,
try to guess what that means in their heads.
And I would do that, and I ended up being like, you know, check out the features on the all-new Ford F-150. And I wouldn't book it, and then I'd see the commercial, and it would be like, check out the features on the all-new Ford F-150. I'm like, yeah, that doesn't sound like any other truck commercial I've ever heard. So I stopped doing it. I was just like, I would, obviously I don't fly directly in the face of the specs, but I don't worry about it anymore. Like, if I figure I'm going to do the voice the way it feels like it should be done, and the execs are either going to like that or hate it, and I'm not going to worry about it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yes.
This one's actually for you. How long have you been doing stand-up, and where did you first start?
Okay. Geez, I'm sorry.
I'd be asking you questions too. In fact, I did.
All right. So real quick, I've been a comedian for 10 years. I started by taking a comedy class, believe it or not, at the Fort Lauderdale Improv. I don't recommend people start that way. I just had no idea how to start comedy. So to me, that was my first guess of how to begin. But to start, you just sign up for an open mic and you just start doing it. And that's the best way to learn, because a comedy class can teach you hacky stuff.
I'm sure.
And then you have to unlearn it. And then, you know, and to bring it back to you with voiceover, is there such a thing as hacky voiceover?
Sure. Let's see how we delicately approach this topic.
Car ads.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, and let me preface this by saying, literally everyone I know or have worked with is awesome. Like, you don't get to be in the room someplace like Cartoon Network unless you're pretty accomplished. You know what I mean? So I don't really see that. But an example is, I think there are some people working who really think of it as literally just making up funny voices. And that's not it. It's acting. It's just acting on mic. So, as Courtney was saying in our panel today, you think about, who is this character? What does he want? You know, what's in the way of what he wants? What are his tactics? You know,
What's his background?
What other people say about him? You know, it's like you approach it the way you do any other acting job. It's just that you have to put all that into your voice.
Right. You have to figure out their origin story, and sometimes, a lot of times, make it up yourself because they don't tell you.
That's right. Yeah.
So you have to imagine it to make that character. It's more than a funny voice, right? It's really making a character come to life. You have to know everything about them to make it sound like a real little thing.
Yeah. And there's kind of a cliche joke among us VO people of the person that comes up, and we've all experienced it multiple times. Somebody comes up and starts doing their Homer for you, and their you know, Rick and Morty for you, and all this kind of stuff. And they're like, you know, people tell me I should be a voice actor because I can do all these voices. And I always try to say as gingerly as possible, well, that's cool, but those jobs are already taken.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of not the point of what you really do. You're being an impressionist, and that's cool, you know, but that's not the job of a voice actor. Yeah.
Oh, do you prefer working with, like, more children-oriented shows, or, like, the more adult-oriented shows, like
Moral Oral? You know, I have never worked on, except for a pilot I did a very long time ago, I have never worked on a real children's show. I mean, I don't even really consider regular show a children's show, because the trend in animation now is to try to write something that appeals to multiple generations, you know? So I would say that I don't think I've ever really done a children's show. So, yeah, and I love working on the stuff that hits all ages, you know? Yeah, back here. I'm looking at you.
Hey there, little man.
Can I do the Rigby voice? Yeah, dude, what do you want me to say? What's your name? Joshua. You're cool, Joshua. Rigby likes you.
It's all the way back.
Hey, what's up? Just kind of a two-part question. First, who do you think you're the closest to of the regular show class, like cast, and B, out of all the characters other than Rigby, would you say you relate to the most?
Oh, wow. I can get stressy like Benson. So, I guess I kind of relate to him. I want to be Skips, but I'm not even close. So, probably Benson. Although I'm a little Thomas as well, so.
You're Soviet
spy. Oh, you have caught me. I'm not the cool part of Thomas. I'm the awkward part of Thomas.
You're the undercover part of Thomas.
Yeah, exactly. I love that episode, by the way. True story, which nobody will hear because that weird thing's going on behind me. When we recorded that episode, we recorded two different versions where we said Grozny spy and Russian spy. And, like, nothing was really going on over there when we first got the episode. When they wrote the episode, Russia was not a big factor in what was going on in the world. And by the time we recorded, like, there was all hell breaking loose, and we couldn't use. We just had to like go with some. We had to go with a fake name.
Oh wow!
Death Punchy. Was there a specific episode?
Death Punchy.
No, I'm. What do you guys want to see?
Death Punchy.
Death Punchy.
Death Punchy.
Everything.
Death Punchy.
Everything.
What are the rest?
So definitely just set up the chair. No, I.
Actually, there's more.
Caffeine.
We're doing Death Punchies?
Yes!
Sweet. J.G. Quintel, he's the guy that made the show.
Volume.
Dick Champs! Dick Champs! Oh, wow, this is really cool, man. Look at this. Wow, we're playing Dick Champs.
It looks just like the cover. Dude, let's play it.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. You can't play a game like this right out of the box. We should stretch it out first. We don't want to pull our hammies, you know what I'm saying? Hey, what are you doing?
Starting. Hurry up and pick your character.
Oh, what?
Obviously,
I want to be player
our
one.
Technology has not progressed beyond 8-bit in the show.
Player two.
I don't want to be player two. He just digs with a sucky pickaxe. The shovel.
Dude, they're exactly the same.
Then why don't you be player two?
I'm not using that sucky pickaxe. Dude, calm down. Let's play Punchies to see who gets to be player one.
Don't do it, Rigby.
Fine.
Don't do it.
Looks like I'm player one.
No, it's not fair. You always get your way. Let's play Punchies. Let's play Punchies. I'm sick of it. Of course I'm not going to beat you at Punchies.
Editorial comment.
Dude, you don't beat anybody at
Punchies. Yes, I do.
No, you don't. Both of these butt cheeks are unrecognizable. If anybody will recognize this as a butt in the future, then we're gonna have to do a complete butt transplant. Stat.
Stop talking! It was only damage to the one cheek, and you know it!
That's right! We used to call you the one cheek wonder!
You better not!
Is that one cheek wonder? I hope he's not trying to play punches with cheeks.
Some dude called me that today. At the signing.
Punches, you'll see! Stop, Mordecai! I hate you!
You better not be messing up my side of the room!
You're ruining my life!
I forgot how much I like this one.
Stupid book! Book? Death Quanto? Learn kicks, chops, and punches in moments. Unlock your full potential today? Yes.
It's a touching story. Really, it is. But I don't know if you're ready for Death Kwon Do.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sam Marin as the.
Death Kwon Do is all about
dude.
Self-defense. But from the sound of it, you just want to hit harder.
No. Can you just teach me something?
Determination. I like that. Okay, I'll teach you some beginner defensive moves. All you gotta do is pick from the sacred text of Death Quan Do. Let's see if we can start you off with Bicep Flex of Death. Well, there's the leg lifts of death. That's a good beginner's move. Pelvic thrust of death. My personal favorites.
I wish you'd gone with that one.
That one. That's the one I want. A death punch.
That, I'm afraid, is not for beginners.
What? Why?
Because you only want to use it to beat up your friend. You're not pure of heart.
What? Don't call me not pure of heart. What about you with your crappy mullet? You're the one who's not pure of heart.
That's it. I'm turning my back on you and counting to three of death. And when I turn back around, you're toast. One of death. Two of death.
Sensei, I think somebody just Death Quan clogged the toilet.
For a test drive.
Calm him on the short.
Alright, Rigby, crybaby time's over. Come on, let's go get some food. I'm by it. Oh, what? Rigby? Ah! Oh, he's gonna pay for this. Death Quan Do.
Where are you, Mordecai? I wanna play you punchy!
Have you seen Mordecai?
No. Who is he?
Oh, so you think you're gonna beat me at punchies? Well, I got news for you. I know your little secret.
That poor park's been destroyed so many times.
Now massage this foot.
But I already did that one.
Then rub it again! But you want to get punched again. And Pops, what's with the easy breezy? Speed it up! My pepperonis are roasting down here! Muscle Man, do you see Mordecai yet?
I can't see anything.
Right here, Rigby.
Give me those. Looks like you learned the ways of Death Quan Do.
Looks like you know how to say things that people are already aware of.
Whatever! You can't handle the death punch.
That sounds like a challenge.
That's because maybe it is a challenge.
Well then, what are you doing up there?
Muscle Man, high fives! Carry me down. Don't drop me! Be careful! Leaning! Here, set me here. What move did you learn?
Why don't you come over here and find out?
What? How come you're not dead yet?
Probably because I learned the death block. It worked pretty good for a first try. Either that or your death punch totally blows.
I'll kill you!
You're never gonna beat me in punchies. finished yet?
Not until I smash you!
Whoa!
That is not good.
Are you afraid of a little lava?
Dude, this is serious! We gotta get out of here!
Never! Not until I beat you and punch you!
Dude, stop! We're gonna die!
I don't care! I'm sick of you always winning!
You got me. You win. We have to stop now because I lost.
I told you I was gonna win! In your face! Yay! I finally get to be player one!
What? That's what this is about? You just wanted to be player one?
That's all I ever wanted!
Dude, you can totally be player one. Dude, quit crying. I said you could be player one.
I know, but what good is being player one now? We're just gonna die in this lava.
Don't worry, dude. I can get us away from the lava.
Really? How?
You think I'm dumb enough to only steal one Death Kwan Do move?
What?
Now, how do you want to get out of here? The death jump or the death dump?
Ah, sick!
Better go with the death jump.
Hold on tight.
Why, yes, sir. I have the death jump and the death dump right here.
Oh, yes! It's finally happening!
Yep, for once being a huge baby actually worked out for you.
Stop talking!
Dude, just hurry up and play. You're just gonna die right at the beginning anyway.
I'll show you.
Snails are bad? I thought snails were good!
No, dude. Snails are bad.
Oh, man! This sucks. I want to be player two.
Thanks, guys.
That was awesome! Would you mind flipping on the light switch for us? Thank you.
Now, did you guys understand all that? Some of it was subtle. You followed the episode? You got all the... Okay, good.
Maybe turning on the lights is not as easy as I thought.
Neither was getting that.
Maybe there's a switch on that side. Is there a light switch?
Boom.
Oh, we got it.
There we go. I don't even know how much time we have left.
We have 20 minutes, but we can actually know. This might end at 4:15.
Please stand by.
But definitely let's take more questions from the crowd. We have a little more time.
So when you watch that, I mean, you're kind of watching your performance.
Yeah.
You watch it with an unbiased eye, or are you like taking things apart as you're watching it?
You know, interestingly about that, that episode was early in the run, and it's the story is so simple. They got a lot more complex after that. So it's kind of a trip down memory lane just because I see how different the show was back then from what it turned out being, you know? And I also have always wondered how the hell he forgot Death Kwan Do, you know? Like, he goes on to be beat up by everybody and anybody and their mothers, and it's like, dude, did you forget that move? Come on, that was really cool. Yeah, exactly. What I do a lot now, when I watch a first season episode, I'll hear line deliveries where I go, oh man, I know what I do with that now, you know, as I got to know the character better. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry. Yeah.
Did you get called
in
for any other character of the show?
I only got called back for Rigby, but in my initial audition, I also read for for Benson. I think Benson and Pops and Rigby, yeah.
What voices did you do for them?
here.
Well, it's been a long time. But Benson was pretty much, what's funny is it's like, you know, Sam and I were kind of, I think, both drawn to the same elements of the character, but it's just, you know, it was like, you know, you guys aren't supposed to eat up on the table. You know, that same kind of like, just kind of like stressy kind of thing, you know? But that was a long time ago. I don't really remember. Yeah. What over here?
Yeah.
Episode, we saw more like ugly side of Rigby.
What
would you say is his more like positive,
most positive side? Yeah, it totally is. I think his most positive quality that we see later is his loyalty to friends and his ability to love. Because I think we find out later that Eileen brings out the best in him. You know.
Yeah,
he
gets more mature.
Yeah. well, they're together. Yeah, they're together. So that's their deal. He was lucky enough to find somebody who put up with him. Yeah, back there. They're pretty much scripted. I mean, we have to be very specific about how much time we take for stuff because we have what's called a storyboard-driven show. The art kind of precedes the voice work. So we have an idea about how long that stuff should go, and we might rewrite a little bit here or there, but it's pretty tight. Thank you.
Bird chirping was...
It was soothing.
It's weird, like some people find that soothing. I'm like, I need to murder someone right now.
In that case, I'm glad you turned it off.
I have to internalize that thought, but now you know.
Yeah.
What do you think about the CJ storyline with Morty Guy?
Think about it. For my money, I thought that she was a little temperamental. Like I wanted him. I would have chosen Margaret just because Margaret seemed like more mellow. You know, it's a tricky thing when you've got a girlfriend who turns into a storm cloud and destroys the city. You gotta. And, I mean, we can all relate to that, right? You thought CJ was a throwaway character? You know, I think that one of the things I actually like about the show is I don't think the writers all always know where they're going with something like that when they start it. As far as I know, Thomas was never envisioned as a Grozny spy when they first came up with him, you know. That's something that they kind of decided later. So I don't even know if they knew how the CJ Margaret thing would turn out.
All right, well, that's it. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah.
You think they'll ever bring Nikolai back?
Yes. Yeah. I do think that they will probably. Yeah. So, what, say again?
Any voice actor that you
want to
work with?
Oh, yeah. I got to work with Kevin Conroy. He was on my list. And Mark, of course, like, you got to work with Mark because he's one of the best voice actors in LA. I'd like to work with Rob Paulson. I've never worked with him. I've done a panel with him. He's a great guy. I've got to work with Troy Baker. Did a couple of episodes of, I think I can say this now, I did a couple of episodes of Marvel Avengers Assemble. And that's an incredible room to be in. There's some of the top voice actors in the country in that room, so. Yeah.
Who's your favorite non-main character? Like, you know,
like, oh, yeah. My favorite non-main character, it would either be the giant babies.
What are their names again?
I can't remember, but they've got weird oldie fashionedy names. Or I also really love Thomas Death's kid. Yeah, the baby that they have to babysit, literally the baby from hell. I like that kid. He's funny. He's voiced by Michael Dorn, so it's hilarious to see big old Worf doing this. You know, I don't want to go to bed. It's not my bedtime yet. You know, hilarious. Yeah.
Rigamort.
Well, but it's not on Cartoon Network, right?
So
That's true. Yeah, okay, yeah, Rick and Morty. No, it really is. I love that show. I just think it's so smart and subversive, just casually subversive. It's great. Did anybody see the thing that was going around the web for a while, just recently, the Simpsons mashup with...
Yeah.
Wasn't that great? I love that.
Pocket Morty.
No. I gotta check it out.
Just came out 2 days ago, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I gotta check that out. That sounds great.
So I have a question real quick, and then we'll get to you, okay? So when you have a regular gig like this as a voice actor, are you still taking auditions for other things, or do you kind of just like step back for a bit?
No, that's a great question. I do. I audition, generally speaking, I get anywhere between... three is a light day, up to 10.
Oh, wow.
And I'm reading for stuff all the time. I do a lot of video games. Most recently, the one I can talk about is Fallout 4. I did 3 voices in that.
Oh, cool.
Of course...
Do you have a studio at home, or do you go to a studio?
Okay. I do, but that's just for... The home stuff is just for auditions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Oh, so...
We had this
off
gentleman.
To you, yeah.
Did you meet Todd, the creator?
I did not meet him. I met Donald Glover, but I didn't meet
Woo!
Him.
Yeah.
And it's so weird to meet somebody like Donald Glover and have him excited to be working on our show. You know what I mean? Because he's so amazing. Yeah.
Have you assembled a home studio of concerts?
Well, it largely depends on what you want to do. I know people that narrate books that will get by on a USB mic. The best USB mic I've ever seen, and I do own one, still sounds a little thin to me. So I have a baby bottle by Blue Microphone, and I run that into just a little digital breakout board, and then that goes into my laptop. And honestly, it's just, I record in the corner of a converted garage room, and I just use U-Haul blankets for sound blankets, and I get great sound.
Yeah. Cool.
And I record on Audacity, which is free. You don't have to you don't have to spend $1 million on Pro Tools. Yeah.
There's a question in the back here.
Yeah. Fallout 4. I was Sheffield trying to bum a Nuka-Cola off you. And I was, I gotta be careful, I don't want to spoil it. Do people know the kid in the fridge quest? No? Okay, then I'm not gonna tell you about that guy.
No spoilers.
I'm a bad guy that shows up in a quest, and I'm a vault engineer. Yeah.
That's awesome. You got a question over here on the side?
Yeah.
Would you be willing to do one of the chants that you do with Mordecai?
Oh, let's see. I'm trying to see what I can remember. How about...
this is the clock song we're setting all the clocks from.
You're welcome. Yeah.
When you go through the Mordecai and Rigby, you guys record those together, and when you do, do you guys high-five each other to get the sound?
Oh, that's great. The short answer is no. We generally record them separately because that way they can mix them and make them sound however they want, right? The other thing is JG has usually been involved in the development of the episode, so he has a sense of how he wants that to sound. So he will, on the shorter ones, he'll just do it and then I do it, and I just listen to him and copy him. The longer ones, we'll do them in chunks, but then they can mix them together. And then some of the short ones, recently, we've been just doing together because we've been recording together since 2010 now, and we kind of like know each other's, yeah. And the high fives are a sound effect.
Aww. But did you record the sound effects?
No, that's probably, you know, some
from
dudes
like
from 19. But yeah, totally, yeah. I say, well done.
Not even with their hands, just slapping 2 steaks together. Sounds way better.
Yeah, that's right.
I have a question. We mentioned scripts earlier, and that, you know, you used to save them all.
Yeah.
When you get a script, do they also give you the storyboard so you can visualize how it's going to be animated?
In fact, I tell them, they still do it, but I tell them I don't even need to see the script. I purely read the storyboard because you know, there's no, the lines in the script have no context. Mm-hmm. You know, so if Rigby has a line that's like, he might have a line that's like UGH. And, you know, I'm like, okay, is he getting shoved? Is he hitting somebody? I don't know.
Yeah, there's a million ways you could just say ugh.
Yeah, exactly. So I always read the storyboard and don't even worry about the script. And we use the script on the stand because the storyboard would be too big, but by then I know what I'm doing. So.
Okay,
yeah.
Interesting.
Question?
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, like, when you get invited to the cons, do you get special perks? Like if you're a Ric Flair fan, they'll take you to meet him or anything like that?
Yeah, they'll do that. I mean, if you're in this circuit, you kind of are also aware of not wanting to be creepy.
Right.
So you try not to be stalky but you know, people will, some amazing people. The guy that created the Ninja Turtles asked me to sign something for his kid because he was, you know, you run into fans of each other's work.
Exactly.
Yeah,
which one,
yeah.
Kevin
so
Eastman?
What's that?
Which one, Kevin Eastman?
Yeah.
Nice.
Well, exactly.
Was meeting him.
I think that was in Auckland.
Auckland?
Yeah, yeah. Way back there. Can somebody repeat that for me?
Why on regular show does always bad stuff happen?
Okay, that's a good question. Why does bad stuff always happen on a regular show? Because if nothing happened, it would be really boring. We have to have some conflict going on so that we can have a cool story to tell you.
Did you mention you had kids in the panel this morning?
I did. I've got a 16-year-old son.
What do they think of you being Rigby, and do they like the show?
He was really into the show, and then he realized that I did it, so he stopped being into it. Yeah. No, but what's funny is like he's you know, I don't know, years ago I was like, hey, do you still watch regular show? I was like, yeah, not really. Like, okay, that's cool, that's really cool. And so, so that happened, right? So for years, about a week ago, he had two girls over, and they were in his room, and I'm sitting at the computer in my room, and I hear, hey, Bill, and I come in and say, what's up? He goes, aren't you the voice of Rigby? And I went, who? And I got the best look out of him for that. But then I did Rigby and, like, you know, came through for him.
So I can,
yeah. So he still pulls it out when it's, you know, yeah, when it's handy.
Real nice.
Yeah, yeah, right. Oh, yeah.
That's awesome.
So yeah, way back.
We just have a couple minutes left, so we'll just take, like, maybe two or three more questions.
Thank you. Way back in the corner. Do I have a least favorite character in regular show? Wow, they're all pretty amazing. No, I guess I really don't. I mean, either I get to voice them, in which case I'm having a ball, or I get to watch other brilliant people voice them, in which case I'm having a ball. So, no, I kind of love them all.
Yeah, it'd be weird if he was like, okay, let's see who I hate.
Yeah, yeah.
Just not
going to
say that.
Well, Sam Marin, I can't stand that guy. No. I mean, the actors are great, and I think the writers do a great job with the characters. Yeah.
Can I take a video of you saying hi to my friend Douglas?
Yeah.
In your baby voice?
Yeah. Hey, Douglas. Douglas. Stop talking! You bet. Right back there. The gentleman with the dark, yes. Thank you.
The gentleman with the dark, okay, thank you.
Yes.
Well, of course you don't know what my name is. Do you have any friends from any other animated shows, like besides Cartoon Network, maybe?
I don't have friends. if anybody would like to volunteer, I...
Did you miss the part about being married with kids?
You know what I'm talking about, yeah. I really love some of the people that I got to work with on Avengers Assemble. Like, Troy Baker's hilarious. I love Travis Willingham and his wife. They're both amazing voice actors and fun to hang out with. I mean, the VAs are really cool people because they're on the whole really talented, but not really impressed with themselves, which is kind of a cool combination, you know. It's like they, you, when you meet these, when voice actors seem happy to be around each other, they genuinely are, which is cool.
So we're gonna, well, you know what? Let's take one more and then we'll wrap it up. I'll let you choose who.
Oh, thanks.
I'll let you be the bad guy.
Okay, let's have a cage fight and then. No, let's do this.
Yeah, his hands went up for a while.
Have you ever used your voice?
For her hands, sorry.
Yeah, I'm sure I have, because that's a thing that JG is really into, is like, not, for some of the smaller characters, not getting too far away from your own voice. So I'm sure I've been like an astronaut or a garbage man or something and just been like, yeah, how's it going, man? You know?